Good afternoon and welcome to the second in the Office for the Advancement of Research's Spring 2015 Public Scholarship Professional Development Series. This workshop is Media Engagement, Journalism, and the Promotion of Ideas. And our presenters for today are two of our fellow faculty from the CUNY School of Journalism. Tim Harper, who is a longtime journalist, author, and editorial publishing consultant and coach. He has under his belt a dozen books and hundreds of articles for publications from The Atlantic Monthly to Airline magazines, and has coached and consulted many nonprofits, corporations, think tanks, and public relations operations. He's been adjunct faculty at a number of major universities in the New York City area, including Columbia and NYU, and joined the CUNY Graduate School of Journalism in its first academic year. He's that school's writing coach and the founding editor of the new CUNY Journalism Press. His co-presenter for today, Carrie Brown, is the director of the social journalism program at the CUNY Graduate School of Journalism. That program began just this January 2015, and it's designed to recast journalism as a service that helps communities meet goals and solve problems. Prior to this, Dr. Brown was an associate professor of journalism at the University of Memphis. She's worked as a reporter and editor for such papers as the Eau Claire Leader Telegram and the Columbia Missourian, and worked with newsroom staff at more than 50 newspapers across the U.S. to preserve core values and adjust to industry changes as the manager of the traveling curriculum program of the Committee of Concerned Journalists. Let's welcome Tim and Carrie.
All right, well, thanks for having us. It's good to get to go to some of the other CUNY schools. I'm relatively new to New York. I just came here in October, so it's nice to get to travel around the city a little bit. This has really long been a passion of mine as someone that both worked as a journalist and also as an academic. I really fundamentally believe that the research that we're doing, as important as it is to get it into journals and, you know, worry about your impact factor and your CV and all those things, I think we really do need to try to get our research out to the public in as many ways as we possibly can. And obviously one, you know, key way of doing that is by reaching out to journalists. And I, just as somewhat of an aside, I know not everyone here does criminal justice work, but I'm assuming a number of you do, given where we are. I mean, I think we're in a really special and unique moment right now to sort of capture journalists around issues of that sort. You know, the Marshall Project, as many of you I'm sure have heard of, launched recently with very high profile leadership, sort of awakening, I think, the competitive spirit of, you know, other news organizations. I'm seeing more coverage in, you know, the New York Times, newer outlets like Fusion, Slate, The Atlantic. Many people are planning series related to all different kinds of things, you know, from prison reform to some of the more recent news events around police brutality. And also from the bottom up, right? I mean, things happening in Baltimore and, you know, Ferguson are obviously raising some issues that I'm sure many of us, you know, have long been aware of, but are now coming in the public eye. So, you know, it's easier to get the attention of journalists when the issue that you care about is, you know, already, you know, in the news, rather than you trying to attract their attention and awareness on something that is not already on their radar. So Tim's gonna talk to you a little bit about, as someone with a long journalism background, as his intro indicated, just really some techniques for talking to journalists, getting on their radar, and then I'll talk also a little bit more about specifically using social and digital media as another way to kind of articulate what you're working on to the media, so.
Thank you, Carrie. It's nice to be in a room with people who care about writers and writing. It's not always the case. I was just sitting here thinking about a few years ago, before we moved back to the city, we raised our kids in Ridgewood, New Jersey, really nice suburb. And I was coaching a game one day after school, and on the sidelines, the kids are running up and down. And a mom comes up to me and said, "Oh, it's so great you do this. I said, the coaching? She goes, yeah, really nice. I said, well, it's nice to get out and be with the kids and, you know, give some back and all that. And she said, well, my husband would love to be a coach. I said, send him out. We always need assistant coaches. And she said, well, he'd love to, but he works. And I said, well, I work. And she said, oh, I'm so sorry. Somebody told me you were a writer. So not everybody cares about writing the way we do. What I'd like to do today is talk a little bit about some history, some background, give you a little bit of context maybe. A lot of this is stuff that everybody kind of knows and kind of thinks about, but looking at it, thinking about it again, and I think will help us going forward with some perspective as we try to get our work published or get ourselves in front of the public and get out word about our work. The first thing is that the news journalism as we know it today is a pretty new concept. In the decades before the Civil War, if years after the Civil War, newspapers were the main way that people communicated, and they were very one-sided, very opinionated, not fact-based at all. It was just you got that sort of paper. It was some people say we're kind of going in that direction again with some various news outlets that supposedly present fair and balanced news. It was only like in the late 1800s as the United States changed, became more of a urban society, more of a service society, more of an industrial society, that newspapers became much more middle of the road, much more based on facts, not so much just opinion and campaigning. There became a real premium on what did actually happen. News might be slanted one way or another. Certainly papers were Democrat, Republican, Whig, Bull Moose Party, all that different type of thing. They had a bias, but the general emphasis was on, we're gonna give you the facts. This is basically where we are, what happened. And now it's funny, there's still that people say where we are now that journalism is dying, the news is dying, and I don't think so. I think the journalism is changing, the news industry is certainly changing, but there's always going to be this premium on storytelling, on presenting the facts, the news. If you think back to like cave people, you know, the cave people lived in a cave with their extended cave family and everything was fine, and one day one of the cave guys notices something funny in the sky over the couple mountains away, and he says, I'm gonna go check it out. Comes back a few days later and says, hey, there's a bunch of other cave people over there. And you know what? They got fire. Hey, I brought some back. You know, here, let's try. He brought, not only brought back fire, but gave the first cooking lesson that night, roasting some meat. Pretty soon this intrepid caveman storyteller is going around, he's going and telling stories and different cave places everywhere he was go. They were welcoming him. They told him about fire, told him about the wheel, told him about the first cave place that had a night watchman or a tribunal of some sort, spreading civilization in that way. And the caveman storyteller loved it because everywhere he would go, they were glad to see him. They would give him the best chunks of brontosaurus burger and he could sleep on the thickest furs, and he had a great life as the prize storyteller. People welcomed him, they loved him. And he had a circuit, and one time he had a circuit he would go to, and one time he went back to one of the places, and he noticed some scratchings on the cave wall. He said, what's that? And they said, oh, last time you were here, Gorg here, our best artist, made some marks on the wall so we can tell each other your stories even when you're not here. Caveman storyteller goes, shit, technology, damn, look at that. And he had to figure out something new to do. And he realized that as long as he kept bringing new facts, new stories, something new, people were glad to see him. At some point, he realized that he could make those same marks on little pieces of bark and sell them, basically, for little pieces of gold and metal or something. That's how, you know, things haven't changed that much. It's not a big jump from that bark scratched with stories on it to Carrie showing us how to do Twitter and Facebook and Reddit and all that sort of thing. Things are changing. The work we're doing now, the way the business is changing with the internet, with the technology, same thing. We're still telling stories. There's always going to be a premium, a demand for people like us, for avenues, for public areas, for people to get news, to get opinions, to get analysis, to get a perspective that will help them in various ways, help them lead their lives, keep them informed. As academics, what we need to do if we're trying to get the word out about ourselves, to get ourselves in front of somebody who will spread the word for us, or get our work into a forum where people will see it and understand it and respond to it, we have to think like journalists do. We have to think about what makes news. What are journalists looking for? One of the things we want to do a little later in this presentation is perhaps hear from you what sort of things you're working on and how we can brainstorm a little bit for what you might do to get your work out there. But if you think about it right now, what makes news? What do we look for? If a story is on New York One or it's in the front, it's in the New York Times, what are some of the things that make it news? People say it's interesting. Okay, why is it interesting? Anybody? Got any ideas? It could be a large group of people. It could have impact. It could have some importance, some significance in your community. The fact that it's in your community can be big. Proximity. If something is close to us, it matters a lot more. For the West Side Spirit, that publication, it matters a lot more. There's a bigger story if a kayaker drowns in the Hudson than if 400 people perish in an overturned ferry in the Adriatic. Proximity, being close to is a big thing. Some of the other things are current, what's constant, what's current interest, something that just happened. Anything unusual, man bites dog. Conflict, whenever there are people at odds doing different things, having different interests, whether it's violent or not, if it's more violent, that's certainly more newsy. Celebrity and prominence. If Derek Jeter breaks his ankle, that's a lot bigger story than, you know, if something worse happens to somebody else. Controversial things that get everybody talking and thinking, that they don't need necessarily be contentious. Think about some of the things that everybody's talking about recently. What color was that damn dress? You know, was it black and blue or white and gold? Everybody was talking about that. Sometimes things are useful. Just the fact that here's some news we can use, service stories. Here's 7 tips to get thicker ankles. Here's something that will help you make better, healthier meals faster. Useful things. Things that have impact, consequence, they're important to us. These are all factors that make news. And when we're doing our work, we need to think about that. The mere fact that we've produced something, we have something to say, we have some numbers, who cares? Finding the angle to that, finding how it matters and how it connects with this list of things that make news is really a key part of the whole process. It doesn't matter how good a study is, how thoughtful we are, there's got to be some reason, and often it's timeliness. Right now, if you look at what's going on with in criminal justice across America, what's going on in Baltimore right now, this is a great opportunity. Look at how many talking heads there are. Sometimes there are people who are bloviating, just having an opinion. More often, though, the people who really are making an impact are the thoughtful people. Maybe they have a different perspective on things. Maybe they write about one of the things we haven't talked about. Maybe they do something for somebody. One of the things we haven't talked about is what's going on with the police or the feelings of the average police officer and the fear that permeates so many departments. Or they might talk about something counterintuitive, how it doesn't matter in Baltimore or other places, in some police departments, whether the police department is black or white doesn't matter. Here are the other issues that really do matter. It's finding something provocative where we can make people say, huh, yeah, I hadn't thought of it that way. That counterintuitive approach can be very, very useful. As a journalist, I'm doing something, I'm writing something, producing something. There are certain things that I have to do. I have to be accurate, fair. It'd have to give both sides balance, some objectivity. But certainly need to be have brevity. I have to be selective in finding the right people, the right facts, the right figures. Very often helps if there's some human interest. The best report and statistics and studies don't really help much if I haven't showed you somebody's face and showed you a little bit of somebody's life and how they're affected by it. I think that those things can really be useful for us when we're trying to get our information out there. The counterintuitive aspect that I mentioned earlier, that's something where you really, there's a real opportunity for academics, I think, where here's another way of looking at it. And here's what is being missed in the big discussion. Here's what you're not hearing on Fox. Here's what you're not hearing on CNN. Here's another way of looking at it. And if you have numbers to back it up, this is becoming the era of data, not just big data, but small statistics can make a big difference too. And knowing how to use those and relate those to real life can really be helpful. Journalists love things that haven't been published before, something new. Here's a book I'm working on that says this. This is what this one chapter is going to say. This might be something you're interested in. I'm available for an interview. Getting things first is really a good thing for many journalists. Look around for what various outlets want. Does New York One, do they like talking heads? Do they need somebody? Maybe they don't have people to comment on various things. You can raise your hand. This is something I can do for you. I can come in. You can call me. The talk radio has become a bottomless well of demand for people who give thoughtful people to give opinions. And saying you're a professor is maybe the next best thing to saying you've written a book. If you've written a book, for some reason, even it doesn't matter how good the book is, the radio people take you and they'll talk to you. You wrote a book about this. You can be the sort of, most of us don't want to be the screaming bomb thrower that is all provocation and very little substance. Most of us, I think, want to be the people who come in with a reasoned argument. We can sustain an argument in face of a bomb thrower with our facts, with our figures, with our calm demeanor. There's a great much more demand through most of journalism for that sort of presentation than for the provocative bomb thrower. The facts and the figures, the numbers, if we bring those in, we've got a great platform to move from. One of the things, we've got something to say. We know pretty much how we want to say it. How do we find journalists? That's a big part of it. How do we make ourselves available? The school here has offers great help with the PR and marketing people. Certainly get to know them, tell them what you have, what you're working on. But any publicity, public relations, or marketing person will tell you, don't rely strictly on me. If you want to get your stuff out, you have to do something about it too. So we always have to be on the lookout, looking for where we might put our stuff. Atlantic is a great example. They run a lot of counterintuitive, thoughtful stuff, articles, opinions, reported essays, which I think would be a goldmine for you folks. And we want to look for that. What could I get in Atlantic? Sometimes we think about what are the big issues of the day? What might be the markets for that? The PR, by markets, I mean publications, arenas where people would be interested in what you say. The PR and marketing people here can help with that, but mostly you can help. If you go to them and say, listen, I got something I think might be good for Atlantic Monthly, they say, okay, let's think about that. And maybe here's someplace else. If Atlantic doesn't want it, maybe here's someplace else. Maybe Pacific Standard wants it. Maybe Rolling Stone would take it. Maybe the West Side Spirit would be interested. There's a lot of things we can do, and I would really urge everybody not to say it's New York Times or nothing, because usually if it's something, else, that's the way that leads to the New York Times, to the op-ed pages, for example. You could keep a list. Places where you'd like to be, where you'd like to appear, where you'd like to speak, publications you'd like to be in, and then start thinking about what you have, what material, what you have to say, what presentation you could make that might be interesting. Contact the journalist, call him up, send him a note. Listen, I have something. Next time something comes up in this arena, next time there's some something with immigration, I've been working on something. I've got a study, or I had a case recently that might be of interest to you. Reporters love that. Having somebody get in touch with them, they want to find new sources, new people. They don't want to be talking to the same people over and over. And when somebody contacts them, you know, they may not fall over themselves saying thank you, but most of the time you're going to be on file someplace. And you can remind them then that when that immigration story comes up, you can remind them, hey, remember me, I'm the professor who sent you that note. Reading a lot, seeing what, looking at what's out there and what people are doing with an eye toward, could that be me? How could I do that? How could I get this op-ed published? What kind of reported essay could I do? What could I bring to Brian Lehrer? And Brian Lehrer is a great example. I love that show. Leonard Lope too, pretty much. But Brian Lehrer particularly, very New York oriented, very criminal justice, social justice oriented. And we have some of our alums are as producers, and they're out scouring the city all day, every day, looking for stories to put on Brian Lehrer. They love ideas. Sometimes the way to cultivate a source is, if it's a reporter particularly, you would like to get something in a particular section of the Daily News, say. Who's the editor of that section? Who writes for that section? Bring them in here. Have them come in and talk. Come and tell us what you do, how you do it, what you think of higher education today, or what do you think of how the police are doing today? What could we do? What could we do to make your job easier? A lot of this, when you're thinking about publicity and getting promotional value out of your work, finding a bigger arena, spreading the word about your work, a real key to that is making other people's job easier. If you make the Brian Lehrer producer's job easier, you're probably going to get on Brian Lehrer. If you make the reporter's job easier, hey, you don't have to go all running around someplace. Here are the facts and the figures you need. I'll be your expert. That's a real key. That's a real key, being available, making it easy for them. I think one time I was consulting for a public relations company. This is not our example by any means, but it was, they had some really rich client in, they were putting on a polo match and like Prince Charles was coming to out on the Hampton someplace. They couldn't get anybody to come to, no reporters to come and cover the polo match. And they, you know, I was advised them sometimes. They said, what can we do? We can't get any reporters to go out there to quag or quog or whatever it was and cover this, polo match. And I said, tell the reporters that you'll pick them up at their office in a limo and drive them out there. And they said, really? I said, yeah, that's the reason nobody's going out there. It's a pain in the ass, you know? And they said, well, all right. So they said, press release, they said, we'll pick you up. They got like 8 reporters to go out there. It was making other people's jobs easier is, that's why we like students who make our jobs easier, isn't it? Where we want to go with what we want to produce, there's a real range, and that's something to be thinking about too. For many of us, a real goal is something like an article in Atlantic or another very thoughtful publication like that, an op-ed piece in the Times. How do we do that? We pitch them. We send them the piece. We tell them this is what we've got. This is what we want to do. The Times runs what, a couple of op-eds a day. They get, I think, about 100 a week submitted. Those are long odds, certainly. I think the range and the length of them is like 750 to 1,000 words. They pay about, I think, $500. But sending something in, even if it's not something they want right away, sending it in, looking like a professional, looking like a reasonable person, a lot of times you'll get back a note that says, sometimes you won't hear anything. That's your answer. But sometimes you'll get back a note that says, we can't use this, but we like you. We like the way you're thinking. We like the way you presented this. Try us again. That's the second best response, and it often is the first step toward a relationship and getting something published. Many of us would love to have something once a year or once every couple years in the Times. But that pitching, sending them what you have, telling them what you have, sometimes showing them if it's an essay or an op-ed, you basically have to show them the whole thing. You have to write it first. But sometimes we can pitch people and say, especially if we know them, if we worked for them before, here's what I've got. I could write this for you. And they'll say, go ahead, or we'll take a look at it. They can be very encouraging. That's kind of at one end of what we do. Actually, books is at the farther end of that. And we can, that's probably something for a different conversation. I've helped many, many people write their books. And we have a publishing operation at Graduate School of Journalism called CUNY Journalism Press, which I think the central office, which is like the Kremlin mostly to me, what happens there. But I think they're interested in what we're doing in our model, and there's some talk of exporting the model at least to other campuses. And I think there's some place like John Jay would be ripe for having its own press producing books. We do books and paperbacks and e-books about journalism and journalists, and to have something like that here for criminal justice, I think would be a great thing. But aside from books, many of us will want to do articles, op-ed sort of pieces, magazine articles. The reported essay, as I said, is a real, really booming these days. That's where you come into something with a point of view, and you present the facts to build it up. You present the case. You probably have some examples of real people in it, but it's not just a screed. It's not just this is my opinion. It's here's what I've done. I went here and I looked. You don't have to go any place, but often people will go somewhere, see something, give a scene, talk to real people, maybe talk to other experts, and present a cogent argument which comes to a conclusion and is persuasive. That's a great vehicle right now for academics. Blog posts, your own blog, why not? If there's a school blog, if there are other blogs, contribute to other places. This is one of the things that we're going to talk about a lot, is becoming part of a community, building a community, and then the community engagement is a huge, huge part of the interactive stuff. And I think that's where I'm going to hand the mic over to you, where we talk about Facebook and everything else. And we'll take... I should have said earlier, if you want to ask questions while we're doing this, I should have said that, raise your hand. We are happy to have this be more of a discussion now, but we certainly want to do that when you start saying, here's what I'm working on, and we can try to help you figure that out.
Yeah, I'll try to be quick so that we have plenty of time for that. But yeah, you guys can stop me if you want to. Well, social media and having a digital... Oh, sorry. I'm very loud. I tried to warn them ahead of time. It's dangerous to mic me at all. Social media and digital media, having a presence there is essentially a way to skip the middleman to a certain extent. You can go direct to the public. You don't necessarily need a journalist to get your message out there. But it takes a lot of time and effort to really build a substantial audience for your work. And even in today's fragmented media landscape where people are getting more personalized news sources, journalists are still, you know, really valuable, as Tim was just saying, to kind of get more eyes and more attention on your work. But I think building a really robust social media and digital media profile is also just a really good way to connect with journalists. You know, just like any of us, journalists are going to Google you before they interview you or, you know, before they even decide to reach out to you at all. If you have clearly articulated your research on a number of different social platforms, such as a blog, like Tim was saying, or on Twitter, much easier for them to understand, you know, what you're all about, where you're coming from. This also allows them to come up with better questions for you, right? And also helps them you know, all of us, even journalists, don't always like having journalism done to them. You know, just the feeling that someone else isn't going to represent your work or your ideas in the way you would like them to. But, you know, help them out. Have some stuff that they can read online that's written for, you know, written more accessibly, not in kind of that academic speak that we use in journal articles, right? I think journalists, really the majority of them, you know, and there's some bad journalists just like they're bad anything, but the majority of them really want to do a good job. They want to understand research when they're writing about it. But, you know, I mean, they don't have a lot of time. Like Tim was saying, I think the most important thing you can do is to make others' work a little bit easier and a little bit faster for them. You know, they're on a deadline, they don't have time to read a book, they don't have time to wade through a lot of journal articles. If they can go in, find your blog, get a really good sense of where you're coming from, what your research agenda is, you know, they're gonna be much more likely to write about you and more likely to write about you in a more accurate way. There's a number of good examples, and I can, through Daniel, I can send some links around that may be good resources. A friend of mine, that her name is Loreen Kelly, she comes from sort of all of these worlds. She worked in TV news for a number of years, got her PhD in journalism, was a professor, taught journalism, and now actually works for the Shelby County Public Defender's Office. So she's sort of bringing journalism, academics, and also now sort of a different role in public information. And they're doing really unique things there. You know, they're blogging, they're using Twitter, they're constantly trying to write about events and issues that they're concerned about in a way that's very publicly accessible. You know, so her job isn't just serving as a liaison with sort of the local media, although that's part of it. Some of it's creating content so they can either reach the public directly or, you know, make it a little bit easier for journalists to understand what they're all about. So that's something to kind of think about a little bit. Just really briefly, and we can talk about this in more detail if you're interested, just some things to think about starting. Twitter is a great place to be, not so much because it's going to necessarily get you a huge audience, especially not right away. It often takes a long time. But a lot of journalists are on Twitter. It's probably among the most popular of the social networks for journalists. So, you know, I don't think you have to be spending 3 hours a day or anything ridiculous like that, but surely all of you are, you know, reading interesting things every day. You can drop on there and share some relevant links. You know, you can at least have a bio that's understandable so people can, you know, find you very easily. You know, you can start following journalists who cover criminal justice issues. You'll know a lot about what they're working on, and you can engage with them as relevant, ideally, you know, before an issue that you do research on comes up in the news. That way they start to, you know who you are and realize that, oh, that might be a really good source for you. You know, make sure that you have a professional portfolio website of some kind that can include a blog, but also, you know, photos of events you've been part of, you know, pieces of your CV. I mean, I still see a lot of academics that just sort of have that very static two paragraphs on the university website. That's great and all, but like, why not make it easier for people to find out in a little bit more depth about what you do? Mine hasn't really been updated very well since I got a new job, so bad on me for that. But there's a number of great examples of, or even teaching resources. You know, some, I mean, we're already translating some of our work so that our students can understand it. But I mean, maybe you can put some of your slide decks that you might use in a class, you know, putting them online so that also a journalist could check that out, or that anyone could check that out that happens to have an interest in it. That can be some really good stuff to do. And like Tim said, I also do recommend blogging, because you can also share those links to a blog post very widely on Twitter, Facebook, you know, whatever the case may be. But, you know, it's obviously a little bit longer than the 140 characters you have on Twitter. Even on Facebook, no one wants to read sort of a really big, long thing in their news feed for most of the time. And you know, there also are a number of blogs often that have a more of a mainstream audience. I mean, I know in journalism research, we write a lot for Nieman Lab, which is at Harvard University. They write a lot about changes in journalism and about the future of news, but that's a great place for, you know, I can write an article there about, you know, my research, and it's gonna get much more widely read, and it's going to help establish me as sort of a trusted expert much more than something that I might publish in a journal. And I don't know what the equivalent would be in another field, but I'm sure, you know, most of them have something of that nature that you could do. So that's just kind of, that was a very quick overview, but I know we don't have too much time left. So yeah, I mean, does anyone have any questions or want to talk about like a particular project they're research that you're working on that you think
I got a question for you. Did you Google me before you knew me?
Yeah, I think I did. Yeah.
Did you Facebook me too? She
yep.
was, she got this job and like she was appointed in the autumn. She was in Memphis. I got a note from the university saying she was appointed. So I Google her. Okay, good. I Facebook her. I see she likes beer. She's from Wisconsin. I thought we're going to get along. So I sent her a note, and you know, we've been friendly ever since, and collaborating on a number of things. That sort of way of using social media can be very useful, greasing the professional and social wheels. I was going to ask you something else. Oh, I know. What about people like you tweet all the time? What about people like me who, when I've got a new story out or I got something that I've done I think is really cool, or I've just published another book or article, and I tweet that and just kind of, there it is. Is that useful, or what would be a better way for me to raise my professional profile on Twitter, Facebook,
right.
any of those? I mean, on Facebook too, I don't put up pictures of food or anything, you know, I will put up something, anything that makes me look like I'm a smart, competent professional that people might want to answer my questions someday or hire me or whatever.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think it's great to share your own stuff, but, you know, I actually think there's an important mind shift that we sort of need to make to be effective social media users, and that's that we tend to think of it as all about narcissism and about selfies and like, look at me, look what I'm doing. I actually think if you sort of shift your thinking to it being a mindset of sharing, I mean, the idea is you have knowledge or insight that might actually be helpful to someone else if you share it. If you kind of think about it that way, I think you become more effective, and then as a side effect, you actually establish a stronger kind of personal brand as a trusted expert. So, I mean, if all you ever do is pop on to share your own book being published, you know, it's hard to establish yourself that way because you kind of come across as spam. But if you're sharing, you know, consistently not just your stuff, but other people's stuff that's relevant to your specific area of expertise, I think that's really what helps a lot. So, I mean, and I think showing a little bit of humanity on social occasionally, like, yes, I like craft beer. It, you know, people, I mean, if that was all I ever posted about, probably wouldn't have a very great academic reputation, but that's...
For about 3 months last year, I think it was. That was all, I think.
Yeah, that's basically it. Yeah.
Go ahead. Right.
I haven't been trained at all. I needed to want something. When I get the training to do it, I heard something you said in the last month. I could go through the popular, you know, journals. I work in Native American Justice, Focus on Prisons. This is a somewhat obscure field. I feel that we have an obligation to put
right.
that out there.
The question is about how somebody who does primarily academic writing translates that into more popular writing, something that isn't necessarily journalism, but might reach wider audiences. That's really hard. I mean, if everybody could do what I do, you know, then you wouldn't need me. Everybody would be a storyteller. Everybody could do that. One of the, when we get students at the Graduate School of Journalism who have had really good academic careers, maybe they've got, God forbid, a master's in fine art writing or MFA or something, you know, the better they've been at academic writing, the harder it is for us to retrain them, to get them to forget all that stuff that's made them a good writer since third grade and become more of a journalist. It is very difficult. Sometimes I tell people to find coaches, find somebody who will help you do that. Maybe that's something that the people here in the marketing department can do. Maybe you find somebody who's a really good 20-year-old journalism student who can help you take what you are working on and put it in much more simple, direct type of sentences. We should do a workshop on how to get over academic writing for popular, because so much of what you do is passive voice, what we consider backwards sentences. You know, for us, the very best communication is a series of simple subject verb sentences with one idea in every sentence. And that's really, maybe sometimes for academics, what I do when I am coaching people is say, make a list. Very simple, make a list. Now, what are the most important things? What's the priority? Now, if you were having lunch with your mom or you were on a bar stool, I call it the bar stool test, and your friend said, what are you working on? Say it the same way you would tell your friend. There's very few whereases or withals or anything like that in a conversation. You don't speak in that backward sentence sort of passive voice. You say, this is the deal. It's hard. It's really hard. And I think a lot of times some academics are good at having such great ideas and getting enough of the idea out there that the journalists, the publication is interested enough to help them. And that has to be pretty strong, though. The most famous academics are the ones who can write well for popular media. It's finding you know, a way to present your stuff and then the right place to present it is a terrific challenge. That's why we're here. That's why, you know, if it was really easy, everybody would do it. I think to start with those suggestions I made about making a list of your, what are the top things in this about this subject that you want to say? What are the five things that you want to say? What are the one thing, the two things, three things you want to say about what's going on in Baltimore right now? That nobody else is talking about, and how would you say that in a simple declarative subject verb sentence with one idea per sentence? And you know, that's really the way to get across to people. When we can carry that on, these things don't need to be long, especially when we write for social media. I had something else I was going to say. Is anything else as a follow-up to that before I go back to something else? Anything else on that? I mean,
I think you're right that a lot of it, academic work sort of builds up to our conclusion and we sort of show through the literature review and the methodology how we got there. I mean, in a way, you reverse it. You know, you say, what is the most important thing I found, and get that out first. You know, because people often, you know, with media, I mean, it's, we call it the inverted pyramid, and not all writing still follows from that train, but people may not all read to the end. You know, how many times do you read to the end of every single news article that you find, right? So, I mean, trying to get that, boom, here's what it is. Here's my main conclusion. If I can only tell you one or two things about my research, here's what it is. And then kind of backing up from there. So it's just a different style,
right,
I guess.
Right, if we say something like, you know, it doesn't matter, the problems in police forces that have predominantly white officers don't necessarily have more racial problems. You know, if we say that, that's the sentence that starts the article, and then we show the numbers, we talk about the different places, give what people say. Having that, the most important things in that priority in a nice list is really a great way to start.
Saying about blogging, but it strikes me as something that requires maybe types of like public blogs that people contribute to? Maybe I'm not thinking about.
Yeah, I mean, I think in. He wants to know if, you know, if blogging, in order to be effective, do you really have to invest a ton of time into it and, you know, blog very frequently, or if there's any other approaches to that. I mean, I think yes, in an ideal world, it certainly is true that the most consistent bloggers get the biggest audience. I mean, you've certainly nailed that. But I think even people that are a little bit more modest, you know, because it's a complement to other things that you do, I mean, you're not trying, if you're trying to make a living as a blogger, I think that would be different. But because it's a complement to your other academic work, I think you can still use it in some ways to establish yourself. Medium is a relatively new platform, very easy to use. And it, you know, it's sort of, the way it's kind of designed, it may be a little bit easier to sort of find an audience there. So that's another thing you might experiment with. And certainly there are, I mean, in each field, there is often some type of blog that, you know, accepts contributions from academics. You just have to kind of find out which one it is sort of in your area. And then that might already have an audience too.
A lot of this, you're right, and so much of this social media or anything else, getting the word out, is about how much you're willing to put into it. You know, the people who, you know, Robert Reich busts his ass getting his stuff out there, and he gets a lot out there. The a lot of it is about finding your tribe, the people who are interested in what you say, getting some authority, becoming one of them, give and take. Sometimes with forums, for example, or if somebody else, there's a publication you like, comment on other people's stuff. Ta-Nehisi Coates writes something, you come in on it. You know, here's what I think about that aspect of reparations. I should have mentioned him earlier. He's a genius at the counterintuitive stuff. He's our colleague at the Graduate School of Journalism, and he's made a wonderful job of building a career based on, wait a minute, let's look at the other side of this. Here's why you think it's a bad idea. Here's why it might be a good idea. But finding your tribe, that forum, the publications, the associations, the groups that talk about the things that you're interested in and can contribute to. And we can't expect, Carrie says, about just being takers about here's my new thing, buy my new book. Asking questions, give and take. A lot of it is about building, the one phrase is finding your tribe, building a community, community engagement, being part of that community, and really does, really can make a difference. You've got a blog, about a particular issue, maybe you put something up a couple times a week. The more focused it is, the more clear, probably the better luck you're gonna have with it. But then you start posting on other publications, other forums, newsletters, other groups, other blogs, and saying, here's what I think, linking back to yourself. Those links are huge. The more you can link to your work, and a lot of people build their platform, is the common word right now, for in social media, by creating links back and forth to themselves, from their Facebook to their blog, tweeting, you know, the more that happens, the higher up you rise on the SEO search engine optimization, and the more likely people are to find you. I know some of this is simplistic to some of you, but it really does work that way, and it does take some effort too. One of the things I do is ghostwriting, and I have on my website and a lot of different things I'll talk about. Collaborating, book doctoring, ghostwriter. And every now and then I'll get a note from somebody who says, you're a ghostwriter? And I say, yeah. They said, my wife loves ghost stories. Would you write one for her, please? And
it's like, yeah. Yeah, it's a long game, I think. I mean, really, consistency over time, like academics are not rock stars. It's not like you start using this stuff and suddenly the New York Times is going to be calling you every other day. But
there can be a real buildup in the same way that we build a journalism career with one little article in a local paper and then you slowly, more things, better things, and people hear about you, they get in touch with you. That happens with academics too, I'm convinced.
Yeah, I think so.
Yes.
So I have some experience writing blog posts every now and then, and also I have some opinion pieces in the papers.
So I think the question is something I've been dealing with as a writer all my life. What do we do about incompetent editors? You know, I'm surprised that journalists would let you see the articles. That's very unusual. Still, that doesn't, you know, I mean, typically a rule in American journalism is we don't show you anything because, you know, if I show you something, then the White House is going to want to see what I write about them before that I publish it. It's been a longstanding principle. However, many of us reporters do routinely show material to medical people, scientists, sometimes academics, if it is complicated, if it is nuanced, to make sure we got it right. We'll show sections of the story, we'll check quotes, that sort of thing. And you can do that when you're dealing with a reporter, you can say, is this going to be fact-checked? Is a fact-checker going to call me? Will you check the quotes with me? This is really complicated. I want to make sure this is right. And I think you should probably start saying, I've had trouble with headlines in the past. Can you show that to me? Maybe they will, maybe they won't. But, you know, a bad headline, a misleading headline once in a while is not a reason to stop dealing with journalists, I think. But all you can do is try to ask. All you can do is ask.
Yeah.
Wow. Did you write an angry letter to the editor?
Yes.
Did it get published? The letter didn't get published.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to control. I mean, you know, obviously there are some bad editors, and I've dealt with them too. But, I mean, something like, look, you know, I'm not trying to question your abilities as a writer, but this is kind of complicated. If there's anything I could do to answer your follow-up questions, and I will actually be at my phone, right, when you're going back and writing the story, so I don't have to, like, try to chase you around to ask a follow-up. You know, sometimes that can help. I mean, it's no guarantee. Like, someone that just isn't very good at their job isn't gonna, you know, that's not gonna help. But I think it can go a long way toward the one journalist that, you know, under a lot of time constraints.
This is it's a price we pay for the system of press freedom that we have. In the same way that we're always gonna need storytellers, as long as we're gonna have a democracy, we gotta have storytellers, we gotta have free flow of information to have an informed citizenry. We have to have an unfettered press to the point where they can do stupid things and make stupid mistakes without intervention from government or anybody else. It's a very elaborate system we have set up, which is weighted, frankly, on the side of the press to encourage a free press. It's a price we pay. Yes.
I should remember that the microphone's necessary for the recording. Some of the things that we have going on right now with the events in Baltimore, you know, obviously being a College of Criminal Justice, we end up having a lot of interview requests, and institutionally, we certainly like to promote any time we see our faculty quoted in a story or on TV or what have you. But I think for a lot of those faculty, that's going to be the only exposure the individual reading that article or watching that show has to them. And I also, knowing those faculty in their research, know that they would like to get across a more nuanced idea of their thoughts on this situation. How do you bridge that? How do you go from a two-line quote in an article to a longer, whether it be a blog post or whether it be some longer idea of what an academic's real feelings on an issue are?
You know, certainly you can. I mean, that's sort of the beauty of today's environment, that you can potentially, you know, write a blog post sort of responding to that article and expanding on it. You know, today a lot of journalists are also much more comfortable than they were in the past, including links. I mean, asking someone to, you know, link to your work. I mean, a lot of them are willing to do that so that people that are really interested can go in and, you know, read a little bit more about the topic or issue. I mean, I think, you know, everything is sort of incremental steps. I mean, I think getting quoted in a piece is a great first step. You know, your name is out there. Other journalists that, you know, in the future that are writing stories, they might pull that clip and say, oh, this guy gave a great interview to the Baltimore Sun. You know, maybe I'll talk to him, right? So I think it's a place to begin, at least.
You could parlay that by letting people know, I did this. I was on Bill O'Reilly. This is what happened. Another thing that can be great fodder for us is writing, commenting about the media, about how Baltimore is being covered, about my experience on Fox News, what happened to me. That sort of thing, that's fair game to write about that. But when you do have a moment of a little bit of the spotlight is on you, maybe you get your 7 seconds or your 15 minutes of fame is there, it is a good idea to follow up on that through social media, through letting other people know. Maybe you write something for the CUNY publication, for the John Jay newsletters, in-house stuff. Maybe you write something for, I can't remember the name of the CUNY-wide magazine, but there are a lot of opportunities if you step up and say, I've got something to say about this, including what they didn't give me a chance to say. There are often people who will listen to that, and within the CUNY system is a great way to start, extending through John Jay and out through the rest of the system to other places in New York City, speaking at universities, offering, letting it be known that you're available is a great first step.
Yeah, and I mean, to me personally, I think that I really wish that public outreach counted more for tenure and promotion, and I think it's not going to count as much as it should unless each of us, you know, as individuals, put that in your tenure file and kind of make a case for this is really important, this matters, we're actually changing, you know, we're getting our work out there in ways that it can have an impact on the world.
So maybe you guys could chat a little bit more. If I'm not mistaken, it's becoming increasingly popular for media venues to either buy or partner with blogs. Like, I think The Upshot is now part of the New York Times. How do you go about engaging that venue? Is it different than The Times? And obviously those are big venues, but just as an example of, you know, do you go through The Times? Do you somehow go directly to them? How are those different?
They're different, and how do you go to this one or that one? The answer is yes. You go to all of them, basically. You know, you find out they have they're different types of they're different publications partnering with each other for different reasons. The New York Times partners with ProPublica because ProPublica is producing really good investigative stuff very economically. And ProPublica is being funded by grants and has a bare bones operation. They don't have a skyscraper on 8th Avenue. So the Times wants that material. ProPublica wants that exposure. So there's a natural synergy there. And when you have something that might, you need to find out what everybody's working on, first of all, or let it be known. And why not go to both of them? Go to the criminal justice reporters at the Times. Go to ProPublica. The Marshall Project, I would think, would be a great avenue for many of you now. Do you know about JJIE, Juvenile Justice Information Exchange? This is something run out of our office. Daryl Kahn, one of our colleagues, a adjunct professor who's also a badass street reporter, is in charge of the New York branch of the Juvenile Justice Information Exchange. I think it's jjie.org. And basically, anything you want to write or say about juvenile justice, he'll publish. And often it gets picked up by other publications. Daryl Kahn, K-H-A-N, daryl.kahn at journalismcunyedu. You can get in touch through me. But check that out, because there are a lot of places we don't think about, we don't know about, and by doing that sort of research and finding places, we can open up new avenues that lead to other things.
Yeah, and I mean, you kind of just got to start and establish yourself as a good writer and a good blogger. There's a woman, I forget her whole name, but on Twitter she's Zainab. She's at UNC. She's had her own blog. She studies digital and social media activism and its impact on, you know, real world protest movements, particularly in Turkey, but other places as well. She just got picked up as one of the New York Times new, you know, they have like 20 new op-ed people that are writing regularly as, you know, not their sort of standard op-ed section, but they have a whole like new voices. But she got picked up because, I mean, she's amazingly prolific. I have no idea how in the hell she does this. But, I mean, she got picked up because they were like, this woman has smart things to say, and look at how great her blog is, you know? So, I mean, sometimes you just got to start doing it. Just start trying, and you'll get better.
She found a tribe with people like you and really parlayed that into a much wider audience. If you look at some of the things that... Distant Witness that Andy Carvin did, looking at that book and the way that social media has been used in news, it can be pretty remarkable. More questions?
Are we out of time?
I think I had one more thing. I can't remember what it was. I was gonna something about blogging. Ugh. Any other questions? We have a few more minutes.
So I've got another more personal question since you had asked
about
what we're doing.
I have a pretty large online education project. We produce a lot of content, a couple of 100,000 visitors a month. We have a managed blog, Facebook page, Twitter, where we're trying to provide some of that content about science education. What's next? Like, how do we, like, what's a next step in terms of getting the word out further about this type of project?
Write a book, do a podcast, do something like Serial. Think a little bigger. Look beyond do a MOOC. Something you haven't done before. That might bring things. Any of these things, though, the real problem, the issue is marketing, letting people know about it, which is why this has to grow kind of organically in many ways.
Right, yeah. I mean, sometimes, you know, these social media tools do allow you to kind of target particular audiences. But, I mean, if you really want to market something on a grand scale, you almost need a budget and you need advertising, you know, and there's a lot of things you can do with that. I mean, it's harder to do just kind of organically. I mean, I think it helps. It doesn't hurt anything to be, you know, sort of constantly talking about it in any way that you can on as many platforms as you can. But, you know, if you really want to do more of like a campaign, I mean, then I think you're getting into sort of a full-scale marketing effort. It needs a little bit of resources behind it to really be effective. I don't know.
Hi. You talked about bringing humanity to your online profile, not just here's what I wrote, here's what I wrote, here's what I wrote. And you mentioned craft beer, I think. But I'm wondering where that line is between humane and too personal, especially speaking to professors who are teaching students who are very proficient online. I think it's counterintuitive for a lot of us to be humane in a very public forum. I hope this is something you're talking about with journalism students too. But as a room of academics, what would you say to us about that line?
I think it's a personal thing, and I don't think there's any one rule. I think it depends on your field. If you're in medicine or elementary education, I mean, I think there's just a lot of sensitivity in those areas, but I think otherwise there's far fewer consequences to being a little bit human than you might think. I'm probably a bad person to talk about this because it just doesn't bother me at all.
But
I mean, I've often wondered, like, I mean, I understand in a lot of ways why not, but also, I mean, most of my personal life, I wish it was so controversial that it would totally freak my students out, but like, at the end of the day, like, I went to the dog park. Oh gosh, now you can't possibly take me seriously as someone that will evaluate. I mean, I think sometimes we get like, not that there aren't concerns, but I think sometimes we overblow like how important that is and underestimate the benefits of actually, you know, being able to connect with people on a human level. I think that matters, you know, and I think trust and credibility come in part from, you know, feeling like you know someone. I don't know.
I think the worst thing you can do is be boring. Dog park. But if you ask yourself, is this something appropriate? It's not. If you have a question about whether it's the right thing or not, it probably isn't. I put up some personal things, but my rationale, I'm a freelance writer. I write about anything and everything, and people hire me or across a broad range of things. So I'll put up personal things that are out in public that I'm doing. I'm gonna go see Jane Lee Hooker tomorrow night, this band. And, you know, I may take a picture of Jane Lee Hooker and the band and put it up on Facebook or something. Not so much to say, look at this, but more so that people who are following me and know me as a reporter will identify, it'll reinforce this idea that I'm a professional out in the world and that I have a broad range of interests. I would never put food up. Things like that. I was one of the original investors in the Brooklyn Brewery, so I do put up stuff about Brooklyn Brewery. But the stuff that helps increase your personal brand, basically. My brand is a longtime, very professional freelance writer who can write an article for you, write about you, write with you, help you write your book. Wide range of interests and knowledge or New York City and beyond. So if I can put something up that shows that, last week I was buying a pinata in Los Angeles. This week I'm at Jane Lee Hooker. Next week I'm shaking hands with a Nobel Prize winner, something like that. A kind of a range of stuff. That helps me, but I really would try to stay away from anything boring or frivolous. And it's, Carrie's right, it's personal.
So this is somewhat related, I think, to the last question and the question of avoiding boringness. And this might not be everybody's situation here, but I manage the social media for the organization I work for and for its director. And I think sometimes the challenge for me is, you know, we engage a lot with other partners, and like you're talking about, share material from our partners back and forth. Sometimes the challenge is doing something that's compelling with and still safe for the organization to do and for the director to do. I think of the example of like Michelle Alexander, the author of The New Jim Crow on Facebook, will post long pieces, you know, she'll link things, but also post a lot of opinion. I don't really have that luxury. And that's the stuff that's really compelling that she does, for example. So I guess my question is about what the line is or what you recommend or even how you recommend engaging other people in the organization, maybe, to be part of the social media presence or be tweeting, you know, their activities.
Yeah, I mean, it can be challenging to, you know, engage people that aren't quite there yet in terms of actually wanting to participate in these things. I mean, that's definitely something that I've noticed. I mean, there are, you know, I think it all comes down to sort of just stopping long enough to kind of think it through and have a strategy sort of laid out that you can then execute rather than just sort of, you know, doing whatever at the time. You know, sometimes it's a matter of taking something that may be sort of boring or dry and breaking it up into different parts. Like maybe there's an event where you can show some photographs, or maybe you can pull out, like if you're a qualitative researcher or something, you can pull out some compelling quotes that might work well in a different venue, you know, to liven things up a little bit. If you can't do, I mean, I think you're right. Opinion is often, you know, that's what grabs people, but if that's something you have to stay away from because you're working for an organization, you know, trying some other things, you know, visuals, can you break something down into an infographic so that people can more easily grasp, you know, data that's really hard to understand? And in terms of engaging other people, you know, I mean, I think it's all about just trying to get them in the mindset. Like, most of these tools are not really that difficult to use. And I mean, I've seen, and I've helped give, like, many, many sort of trainings, but then people walk away and they don't, like, nothing really changes about, like, they're not using Twitter any differently. And I think that's because, you know, until you can sort of get that mind shift where you understand how this is valuable both for you personally and for, you know, your organization or the people you're serving, you know, they're not really going to do it.
I think that's a key. Part of it is figuring out what you can put up, and usually the smaller, more focused, more concise, like our list of priorities, our main, our bullet points, our bar stool talk, that's really one part of it. The other part of it is changing the culture of the organization. So many organizations now hire people to do social media. They know they need somebody. They don't know what social media is. They know that they have these ideas of how they want to be represented. And often it's up to somebody like you to manage up and convince your bosses, this is what we should do, this is why, this is the benefit of it. Changing from within, and that's harder.
Some media companies, kind of contractors, propose something like, so we work with partners around the country who aren't employed by us, but I've had companies propose, for instance, a webinar that would train our partners to engage in social media around our messaging, and that sounds really unrealistic, that, you know, chiefs of police or law enforcement are necessarily going to be on message with our, or even show up for a webinar. How worthwhile do you think something like that is? Am I being pessimistic?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that's, you know, it's kind of tricky. I mean, I think webinars, you know, are always sort of, I mean, just, yeah, like you just hear that word and you're like,
how,
oh,
how often do you go to
snooze,
one, you know?
You know? But, you know, like anything else, you know, I think you can make them a little bit more dynamic. I mean, I think it's worthwhile to try, like, a lot of different things, and I wouldn't, you know, sort of say, like, oh, yeah, that's really going to, you know, totally improve our training efforts. But, I mean, I think if you view it as sort of a kaleidoscope of all different kinds of things that you're doing, and that's one of them, that eventually you can, over time, you know, make a difference there.
I think in that setting, or in pretty much everything else we've talked about, whether it's getting your material out in a more popular way or expanding what you're doing about your program, a real secret to all this, it's not a secret, it's just hard to do, is storytelling. Tell a story. Make it a story. It's about people. It goes from here to there. It's something it can understand. You know, the I love you may be the three most powerful words in English, but the four most powerful are tell me a story, or maybe once upon a time. Those two kind of compete. But we always want to know what happened next. And having a narrative really, you know, here's this situation. This is what happened. This is what happened. This is why it happened. Here's what might happen. Here's what could happen. That sort of thing. Having a narrative is really a key to bringing people in and getting them interested to buy in, to see not only what happens next in that story, but what story are you going to tell next?
So while we still have a few folks here, I just wanted to point out that our public relations officer, and what is your title? You have a directorship. Okay, Deputy Director of Communications Doreen Venus is here, and I'd just like to give her a couple of minutes to introduce herself and what our Office of Marketing and Development, what services they offer in terms of engaging with the media.
Oh, okay, good. I wasn't here to hear that. Okay. So my name is Doreen Venus. I work in the Communications Office, and, you know, we work to promote the college to multiple internal and external audiences, and part of that includes media outreach. So, you know, we are a resource for you. step one is letting us know what's going on. So a lot of times we have to, you know, we get requests from the media, and a lot of it is me sort of doing like investigative work, trying to figure out, you know, we do keep a running list on topics, you know, professors, faculty, research that we know are regularly of interest, but we want to know about all interesting things that are happening, you know, with faculty. We get an inordinate amount of media requests for day of stories, and that's a challenge. But, you know, we develop relationships with these reporters, and we know what they're writing about. So, I just want to bring up, like, Baltimore. You know, we kind of know the big issues, but, you know, the curfew. Well, if one of you has written something in the last 6 months about, you know, municipalities and curfews, that could be of interest, and that might not be the biggest part of that story, but, you know, we can work with you to maybe, you know, let a reporter know about that, and maybe in the future they'll be interested in other things that you're doing. I mean, that's just one example. We also work to promote, you know, faculty research to the university, because they also have more resources than we do, so, you know, they also get requests from the media, and they filter that to us on broader topics. So the media kind of knows to come to us for the criminal justice related stuff, but you know, for the humanities and other areas, there is interest in that. So I think I guess what I want to get across, you received a lot of information, but letting us know about what you're doing is really important. If you have, you know, if you have interest in media outreach, we certainly can help you think that through. What makes the most sense? Whether it's an event or a publication, research that you have coming out, you know, come talk to us. And I don't know if this was discussed, but your academic pages, I would say, please update that as often as you can. And it's great to list all of your research, and I keep in mind that, you know, lay people are looking at this. So sometimes, you know, if you can have a summary just in general terms what your research area is, and then of course, you know, you have your vitae and all of that, but I think making it reader friendly, because sometimes I'll read, you know, some of this and I'm still not sure exactly what your expertise might be, and that's nothing against you. It's just I'm not aware. So I mean, these are just some immediate things that I think. I don't know if this was discussed earlier.
No, I mean, I think you hit on, those are really key points. And there's actually been research in the Journalism Academy about sources. And it's like, there's two main things. One, do you answer the phone when they call? And two, are you able to say something kind of interesting? You know, do you give a good quote? Not inaccurate, but interesting. Those two things determine a lot of the sourcing in media articles. Because at the end of the day, if your boss says, I need it by 5, and you're calling, you know, and calling, it's the person that answers, you know, that you're going to call back the next time you decide that you need a source.
The building off of your academic pages is a great idea, not only for putting material up and linking elsewhere, but, well, for creating other things you can link to. For instance, if your specialty is something like curfews, maybe you create a separate website about, you know, city curfews, curfewcontroversy.com, something like that that links back to your page. People go to Curfew Controversy. Maybe they get your academic page, but you can forward to that. Maybe they get a separate page and link to you. You can be pretty creative about what we put up on the web and how we use different web pages to get the word out and tell people who we are.